If a man don't work, don't eat. The Bible says, in all your beginnings, get some understanding.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Somebody say, ask.
Ask.
Then you gotta seek. Somebody say, seek.
Seek.
Look at your neighbor, say, no.
Ah.
It's great. And great to be great to be with us. In the book of Numbers, the 19th chapter. And now listen, I'm gonna have you do a little training today because we gotta get some things in our souls and in our spirit to help us understand this helper. Praise God.
Yeah.
Bless his name. I don't have a role. So you know my intention. I don't have a role. You know my intention. Praise God. So we're gonna read Numbers. And you're gonna need these. So I beseech you to write them down. You'll need Numbers. The 19th chapter. Praise God. Really all of the chapters probably about the helpful, but today we're focusing on, amen, verses 7 through 12 in the book of Numbers. And in the book of Ephesians. The fourth chapter, we're going to read verse 9. And in 1 Peter, the third chapter, we're going to read verse 19. I'm in no hurry. Y'all ain't no hurry on you.
Nope.
So we're going to take our time to turn there. Praise God. Those of you that can't stand, for whatever reason, you may sit. But those of you that are able, if you will stand for the reading of God's word. Numbers, the 19th chapter, starting at verse number 7, I'm going to read through verse number 12. Praise God. Will you find what you say, amen?
Amen.
Then the priest shall wash his clothes, and he shall bathe his flesh in water. Somebody say water.
Water.
And afterward he shall come into the camp, and the priest shall be clean unto evening. And he that burneth her shall wash his clothes in water, and bathe his flesh in water, and he shall be unclean until the evening. And a man that is clean, somebody say clean,
clean,
shall gather up the ashes, underline that, somebody say ashes,
ashes,
of the heifer, somebody say heifer,
heifer,
and lay them up without the camp in a clean place, and it shall be kept for the congregation of the children of Israel for a water of separation. It is a purification. Somebody say purification.
Purification.
For sin. And he that gathereth up the ashes. Somebody say ashes.
Ashes.
Of the heifer. Somebody say heifer.
Heifer.
Shall wash his clothes and be unclean until even. And it shall be unto the children of Israel and unto the stranger. Somebody say the stranger.
Stranger.
You need to underline that because it's to the children of Israel and the stranger that sojourneth among them for a statue forever. Somebody say forever.
Forever.
He that toucheth the dead body of any man shall be unclean 7 days. And he shall purify, somebody say purify.
Purify.
Himself with it on the third day. The it there is the ashes. Somebody say third day.
Third day.
And on the seventh day. Somebody say seventh day.
Seventh day.
He shall be clean. But if he purify not himself the third day. Somebody say third day.
Third day.
Then on the seventh day he shall be not clean. Glory to God. That blood there preached by itself. Underline third day, then seventh day. Now turn with me if you will. Now these which we get ready to read seemingly is not going to fit into what we're talking about, but they are later. Praise God. Turn with me to Ephesians 4. This is a good setup. Ephesians 4. Chapter 9. I'm going to teach this thing to you today, and then we're going to be done with this help. Amen. Ephesians 4. Ephesians the fourth chapter and verse number 9. This is important. Please Please listen to this. Because this goes against your Sunday school teaching. Ephesians 4 and 9. What's it?
Now that he ascended, what is it but that he also descended first into the lower parts of the earth? He that descended is the same also that ascended far above all heavens, that he might fill all things. He first descended into the lower parts of the earth. Mark that. Now, come with me to 1 Peter 3 and 19, and I'm going to leave you alone for a minute. Listen, you need to memorize these last two, because in the end, we're going to come back here. 1 Peter 3 and 19 says this: by which also he went and preached unto the spirits in prison. I'm going to read it again. By which also he went and preached unto the spirits in prison, which sometimes were disobedient, when once the long-suffering of God awaited in the days of Noah, while the ark was preparing, wherein few, that is, eight souls, were saved by water. So he went down and preached into hell to the souls that were in prison. Now, will you pray with me? Dear Heavenly Father, in the name of Jesus, by the power of your Holy Spirit, be with me now, God. Help me to lucidly explain and extrapolate your text, God, that the people might be able to receive from you this engrafted word that is able to save, deliver, and set free. Hide me behind the cross. Crucify my flesh on this morning. Touch my lips with coals from the altar, O God, that all my iniquity be taken away from me, that this word might hit the bullseye of the heart. Let me decrease, that you increase. It's in Jesus' mighty name that we pray. Let the church say amen.
Amen.
You may be seated if you can in the presence of the Almighty, all-wise God. Understand that helper. Now, those of you that were here last week, you kind of got the ups on those that were, praise God. I pray those of you that just listening to this message for the first time, get that CD from last week so you can really understand what's going on right now. Praise God. Y'all remember on last week, just quickly, we talked about the word tehor, which means doors are what?
Open.
Praise God. And we talked about the word tameh, which means that doors
are closed.
Now, where we left off last week, the heifer, praise God, that heifer, that red heifer, that perfect sacrifice, was slain in such a manner outside the camp. And his blood was thrown toward the doors of the temple. And God, hallelujah, opened the doors of the temple. Amen. The way is open for worship. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We understood that from last week. Praise God. But this heifer is two-phased. The first phase we talked about last week was the necessity of getting the doors open and the way being met. But now this week, the heifer has another function. And that function is to sanctify the people. Somebody say glory.
Glory.
Firstly, the doors of the temple has to be consecrated and open for worship. And now the people must be sanctified or consecrated to worship. Somebody say glory.
Glory.
Now stay with me. I need you to stay attentive. In the Talmud and in rabbinical literature, it tells us that Solomon, with all his wisdom, the Bible says Solomon was the wisest man on the face of the earth. Solomon, with all of his wisdom, understood mysteries, for he battled the Queen of Sheba with all of her hard questions. He answered them like that. But they tell me there is one thing that Solomon did not understand. That if you pay attention to me today, you don't understand. Oh, praise the name of God.
Amen.
The rabbi said, Solomon didn't understand why the thing, this heifer, in Numbers 19, the thing that came to make everybody clean,
when they came in contact with it, it made them unclean. Solomon didn't understand that. And I'm going to read these texts with you again so you can pick up what I'm saying. Now, in verse 7, it says that the priest shall wash his clothes, and he shall bathe his flesh in water, and afterward he shall come into the camp, and the priest shall be unclean until even. That's because he slayed the heifer. The very cleansing agent that came to make them clean caused the priest, who was already clean, to be unclean. Solomon couldn't figure that out. And I must admit to you, when I first read that, I said, now, God, what you doing here? It would be like me taking some bleach, spraying it on something, and the bleach causes the thing to be dirty instead of taking the stain out. So Solomon couldn't figure out, God, why would you send this red heifer to cleanse the temple and us? And then, but when the priests come near it, we become unclean. Watch this. He couldn't figure it out. Now, not only the priest, but he that burned that heifer, in verse number 8, became unclean just from burning the heifer. Now stay with me. The man that gathered up the ashes of the heifer would become unclean. Now listen. So all of these priests that came in contact with the heifer became unclean. But the red heifer is the thing that cleansed the people and the temple. See, he couldn't figure that out.
I can't either.
I praise God. That's what I wanted to say. That's because God was trying to teach the priest and us a lesson. That it doesn't matter how clean you already are. When you come in contact with the sacrifice, you realize you're really dirty.
Yeah.
Let me give you another example. Isaiah, in the book of Isaiah, the 6th chapter, says, I saw the Lord high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple.
Hallelujah.
And when Isaiah saw it, he said, woe is me, for I am undone. For I am a man of unclean lips, and I have seen the King of Glory. Anytime you come in contact with the Holy God, you start seeing the deficiencies in yourself.
Amen.
When you come in contact with holiness, the beauty of holiness, you realize, my God, I got work to do.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Glory to God. Stay with me now. Stay with me. The cleansing mechanism made the priest dirty. No. That's because he's what God was saying to them. No matter how clean you think you are, no matter how much you scrub, according to the law of Moses, you have to come and be cleaned by the sacrifice I provide. That no matter what you do, it's not good enough. No matter how you do it, you can't clean you enough.
That's right.
Glory. And now look at God. God says, he literally took this heifer and said, listen, I don't want it to be a part of the regular sacrificial system. Take it outside of the camp. In other words, I'm going to provide a way to be clean that's not a part of the law of Moses.
Yeah.
Everybody.
I'll send him outside the camp. And just because you think you're clean, when you come in contact with my sacrifice, you're going to become dirty.
Not good.
Now watch this. He was showing the priest that no matter how much you rely on the law of Moses, I'm going to make a way for you to be clean.
that you got to participate.
Amen.
It's not enough just to be a part of the service.
That's right.
It's standing in the garage don't make you a car. And just because the priests were performing the service didn't mean that they were going to be clean. The same thing that cleaned the people is going to clean you too.
Yeah.
Oh, glory to God. Nobody can be clean apart from the sacrifice.
Amen.
So the priests, because they were clean already, became dirty when they came in contact with this red heifer. How many of you know no preacher, no evangelist, nobody can be clean outside of the sacrifice?
Amen. Mm-hmm.
We all, laity, and priesthood, got to apply the sacrifice to our lives. Just because I'm up here don't mean I'm clean.
Amen.
Just because I'm preaching and just because I'm teaching and officiating a service does not mean that I'm clean.
Amen.
The sacrifice has to be applied to me just as well as you. Nobody gets by.
Right.
So if you think you already got it, you have to go back and get it again.
Amen.
Glory to God. This is the message that God was teaching his priestly class who came and thought they were already clean, thought they had it all together. But when you face the beauty of holiness, realize, oh, I gotta get this thing right.
Yeah.
So they had to go through the same process as Glory. Stay with me now. Now, Romans, the 10th chapter, really explains to us what the mindset of the priest was like. This is stay with me. For it says, my dear brother, I bear them around. And my hope and desire for Israel is that they all be saved. For I bear them record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to the knowledge of God. Because they have not submitted themselves to the righteousness that is of God, they have gone about to establish their own righteousness. For Jesus Christ is the end of the law toward righteousness to them that believe. He says, Moses spoke of the righteousness that was of the law when he said, the man that doeth shall live it thereby. But the righteousness that is of faith speaketh on this wise. Say not in mine heart that I shall ascend into heaven. That is to bring Christ down from above. Say not that I shall ascend into the deep. That is to bring Christ up from the dead. But what saith it is that the word is not thee. Even in thy mouth and in thine heart. And this is the word of faith which we preach. That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth and believe in thine heart that God raised Jesus from the dead, thou shalt be saved. For the same God is rich toward all who believe in him, both Jew and the Greek. Romans, the 10th chapter. Verses 1 through 17. In other words, they didn't understand that God was going to provide another way of salvation. A way for only Jew and Gentile to both be saved. Somebody say, glory. Stay with me. Stay with me now. This is going to get heavy in a minute. Stay with me. Stay with me. Now, this sacrifice. In order, listen to this now, here it goes. You need this to understand this full time. Listen. In order for a sacrifice to be a sacrifice, it had to literally become the thing
they came to get rid of.
Think about this for a moment. In order for a sacrifice to be a sacrifice, it had to literally become the thing that it came to get rid of.
Wow.
I'm going to say this another way. The sacrifice literally had to take upon itself the very thing that it came to deal with. So, when they sacrificed a lamb for sin, the lamb literally had to become sin. And then they would do what they call a burnt offering and put that lamb in the fire, right?
Yeah.
The fire was there to burn up all of the sin that's represented. The priest would lay his hands on the head of the lamb, transferring all the sin of Israel onto the lamb.
Yeah.
And then they would take that lamb and burn him up. Totally. Nothing left of the lamb. That's because, watch this, the sacrifice must become the thing that it's coming to get rid of. Keep that in your mind. If you keep that in your mind, you won't be lost. Right? Let me give you another example. Let me bring it on down home closer. To keep you from getting the flu, they give you a shot with the flu in it.
Amen.
Think about that for a minute.
Yeah.
To keep you from getting the flu, they give you a shot of the flu. And not think about it. That's because the antidote is in the disease.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
The antidote is in the disease.
Yeah.
Somebody gonna get this in a minute. Stay with me now. So when we wanted something or needed something to deal with humanity's problems, how do you know it had to be a human?
Yeah.
Okay, let me say that again. In order to deal with humanity's problems, he had to come as a human.
Amen.
The antidote.
Great.
Okay. Had to come from the disease.
Yeah.
This is too heavy for y'all. This is too heavy for y'all. I thought I was beginning
to pray. Y'all
get that? Okay, then go praise God. Watch this thing. I can go further. That's good. Okay, pray. Okay, watch this. He that knew no sin had to become sin for us.
Yeah.
Now, let me show you why that is. You cannot be an effective minister if you are afraid to get dirty.
Yeah.
Let me say that. You can't help nobody if you are afraid to get in the mud with
them. That's right.
Now let's say that again. If you can't meet people where they are, you cannot effectively bring them out.
That's right.
You just can't help. I can throw word over the fence at you all day, but until I actually climb over, that you can examine me and see that I'm for real, I can't bring you out.
Yeah.
So the priest had to understand that they had to get their dirty.
Yeah.
In order to minister to the people.
Yes.
And that's why he that knew those things.
Became
sin for us.
Glory.
Are you getting where I'm going?
Yeah.
So the helper, which was perfect, watch this now. Understand the duality. The helper was perfect.
Mm-hmm.
But it had to completely and totally take up
on itself the sin of death. So no matter how clean you were, if you touched it, you became unclean. Now y'all go get that in the bed. Y'all stay with me?
Yeah.
I don't know, that didn't sound too good. You at home, my dear, you stay with me? Praise God. Now watch this. Watch this. So, now here we go. Y'all need this. Last week, the heifer was slain, and the doors of the temple was open. Right?
Yeah.
Now, listen to me. That's all that heifer could do in the form that it was in. That's it. Was open the doors of the temple. So now God says, I want you to burn that heifer up. I want you to set that heifer on fire. I want you to throw some cedar wood in there. I want you to throw some hyssop, some crimson in there, and I want you to burn that heifer up. He said in the first, he said, I want you to burn up everything. I want you to burn up skin, flesh, even the dung. He said, I want you to burn it up.
Yeah.
Stay with me now. But that red heifer was unlike any other sacrifice. Even though it was burnt up, the fire didn't destroy the heifer. It transformed the heifer. I'm saying, y'all ain't keep up in the week. Every sacrifice that was a burnt offering was burnt up completely. There was nothing left. Not even ashes. Listen to me now. You're not listening to me. I don't care if it was a ram, a lamb, when it was burnt, in a burnt offering, everything was gone. It was burnt up completely. Nothing was left. But this heifer, that's because all the other sacrifices, when it went into the fire, God consumed the living fire, burned up the sin and everything with it. But now, in order for this heifer to be different, it has to go in the fire, and then something has to be left over. So the fire didn't destroy the heifer. It transformed the heifer.
Yeah.
Think about that for a moment. If that heifer would have burned completely up in the fire, then it was imperfect. And it would be discounted. Because something was supposed to be left over if it wasn't perfect or imperfect. Watch this. Fire doesn't destroy perfection. It destroys imperfection. Did you get that to soldier?
Yeah.
So in this fire, when this heifer went in the fire, if it was perfect and completely full of the sin of death, there was supposed to be something left over. Look at today and say left over.
Left over.
Oh God. Stay with me now. Are we going? Are you staying with me?
Yes.
The purpose of the fire wasn't to destroy the heifer, but transform. The heifer. Now, what comes out of the fire? Somebody say, out of the fire.
Out of the fire.
Is our blessing.
Thank you.
What's left over is our blessing.
Yeah.
Glory. This morning, told this to you. 15. Nothing gets you ready for work like fire. You can read books, you can attend classes, but nothing will prepare you for worship like the fire.
Yeah.
Somebody say Hebrew boys.
Hebrew boys.
They had read about God.
Yeah.
In the text. They had been told about God.
Yeah.
But they didn't meet God until they got in the fire.
Great.
Watch this now. They went into the fire bound up, hands and foot.
Yeah.
The fire didn't destroy them. But the fire is of no consequence now.
Amen.
Stop worrying about what you was before you went in. The blessing is in what comes
out.
The blessing is in what's left. Sometimes we lose friends in the
fire.
How do you know that when you get in there, or when you get an ailment, or when you're hurting, or when you're laid up? How many of your friends will start acting funny while you're going through the fire? But I got a word for you. Anything you lose in the fire wouldn't work too heavily in the first.
All right, brother.
Are you hearing what I'm telling you?
Showed up on the seventh day
and hadn't been cleansed on the
people with this if you can.
Take the time.
How do you know what day we in right now? We in the sixth day.
Yeah.
Come on.
Boom. The seventh day is completion.
Yeah.
That is the judgment of God. Because the consummation of all that God has appointed 7 days, which is representative of 7 years that fulfill all history and time. If you show up on the seventh day and hadn't been cleaned and washed on the third day, you were in trouble. I'm getting ready to get out. You had to be sanctified on the third day by the ashes of the heaven. Then on the seventh day, you would be clean. Say it with me. Now get ready to bring this thing home. Okay, get ready to bring it home. Listen to this. Ephesians 4 and 9. I promise I'll get it.
Take your time.
I'm trying to, man. But I don't want to lose nobody. Hey. I don't want you to go sleep on. But listen to them. You better bring this thing on. Last week, we talked about the fact that temple was representative better than any other sacrifice of the sacrifice that Jesus did for us on the cross.
Yeah.
How do you know that when he went to the cross,
yeah,
that opened up the doors of the temple?
Yeah. Right.
They tell me that when God turned back to the people, that the veil was torn from the top down.
Yeah.
But that Heifer had more work to do.
Yeah.
The first part just opened the door.
Yeah.
But we got to deal with the people.
Yeah.
Oh, glory to God. So the Bible tells me.
Yeah.
We're going to get your Sunday school teaching, but I learned it as a child that when Jesus gave up the ghost,
yeah,
and he went to heaven to be with the Father.
Yeah.
And then he came back to earth, talked with his apostles for 40 days, and then went back to heaven. That's what we were taught as children.
Yeah.
But the truth of the matter is, from the book of Ephesians 4 and 9, from 1 Peter 3, 19, tells us that when Jesus gave up the ghost,
yeah,
that he did not go up first.
Yeah.
The Bible says that he went down first,
yeah,
into the lower parts of the earth.
Yeah.
How do you know when he died, he went down in the fire?
Yeah.
Took your sin,
yeah,
and my sin,
yeah,
and your death,
yeah,
and my death. Stay down in that fire,
yes,
3 days and 3 nights.
Yes.
It tells me he went down there preaching unto the spirits that were in prison.
Yes.
But how many know your blessing is in what came out the fire?
Yes.
The Bible says that on the third day, polished in the fire.
wasn't the perfect sacrifice. But because he came out the fire, your blessing and my blessing isn't what came out the fire. Because he got up.
During the Bountiful Word broadcast. If you feel that this message has really touched your heart, I want you to contact me at thelovejesus20@gmail.com or visit us on the webpage at nolimitsholytemple.webs.com. Listen, maybe you're out there and you're looking for a church family. If you want to come to a place where there's no scandals and where the Word of God is being preached without compromise, this is the place for you. Maybe you felt in your heart that God has called you into ministry and you're looking to be trained. I'm telling you, this is the house for you, where the Word of God is being preached without compromise. We would love to see you here at the temple.